In this session, we are going to describe the cranial nerve number 5, the trigeminal nerve. This is the trigeminal nerve, the 5th one. The same thing will start by the functions and the deep origin. The functions are general somatic afferent fibers, which will go to the mesencephalic nucleus of the trigeminal in the midbrain, this one here, the main sensory nucleus in the bones, that one, and the spinal nucleus of trigeminal. As you can see, it's three parts, one for trigeminal, for vagus, and for the accessory nerve. The second or the fourth nucleus, second function with the fourth nucleus, special vessel afferent to the muscles arising from the first pharyngeal arch. And this is the motor nucleus of the trigeminal. That is the deep origin of the trigeminal nerve. The superficial origin, this is the largest cranial nerve, as you can see here, is very large and very short at the same time, arising from the middle of the body of the bones at the origin of the middle cerebellar peduncle. That is the superficial origin. Now the functions again, general somatic afferent and special visceral afferent. The deep origin from the mesencephalic nucleus of midbrain, the principal or main sensory nucleus in the bones, the spinal nucleus trigeminal in the medulla, and the motor nucleus trigeminal in the bones. Superficial origin, from the ventral aspect of the bones at the origin of the middle cerebellar peduncle. Here, the course and the relations. As we said, it is the largest and the shortest cranial nerve. Its short trunk is formed of a small motor and large sensory, which you have seen it with the cavernous sinus. The sensory root is a branch of the semilunar ganglion, which lies near the apex of the vitreous part of temporal bone, covered by the dura, which we call it the cavum trigeminal, the inner layer. Its convex surface of the ganglia give three branches, or better say, receive three branches, the ophthalmic, the maxillary, and the mandibular, which join or joined by the motor root. That is a general distribution of the cutaneous nerves supplying the face, the three branches, which are the ophthalmic for this area, the maxillary for this area, the middle part, and the mandibular, which is supplying this area. Actually, usually we got a line from the tragus to the outer end of the eye, and another line to the outer angle of the mouth, to divide into upper, middle, and lower areas, ophthalmic, maxillary, and mandibular. This part is the auriculotemporal, which overlap that of the maxillary to reach the scalp. That is the sensory distribution to the face. Let's start by the ophthalmic division. The function, it is a pure sensory nerve, general somatic afferent. The course and the relations, this is the smallest of the three branches. Passes forwards in the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus, we have seen it, below the trochlear and above the maxillary nerve. Just before it enters orbit through the subarachnoid fissure, it will divide in its three term branches, which are the lacrimal, the frontal, and the nasillary. The branches of the ophthalmic are the lacrimal nerve, this one here, that is the lacrimal nerve, which enters the orbit through the lateral part of the subarachnoid fissure outside the tendinous ring, then pass along the lateral wall of the orbit. We have seen it there in the coronal section of the orbit, above the lateral rectus, with the lacrimal artery, near the lacrimal gland here, as you can see. And by receive communication from the parasympathetics to the lacrimal gland from the zygomaticotemporal nerve, secretor fibers to that gland, and supply the lacrimal gland sensation, general sensation, and give a palpebral branch which supply the lower, the upper eyelid. That is the ophthalmic branches. The second is the frontal nerve, that one here. That is, you can say, with the necessary, both of them are the largest branches of the ophthalmic nerve. It enters the orbit, as you have seen it, in the subirbital fissure, outside the tendinous ring, just middle to the lacrimal. The most lateral was the lacrimal. I mean the most lateral, yes, the lacrimal. In the orbit, it runs below the roof, directly under the roof, above the levator palpebris superioris. It ends by dividing into supratrochlear and supraorbital. That is the frontal, supraorbital, and supratrochlear here. The important one, or again the largest one, enters the orbit through the subiro-orbital fissure outside the common tendinous ring between the two divisions of the oculomotor, as we have seen it. It crosses the optic nerve from lateral to medial. We have seen it in the medial wall of the orbit between the superior oblique and the medial rectus. It ends by giving those branches, sensory branches to the ciliary ganglion, long ciliary nerves to the eyeball. The eyeball is very sensitive. When you press on it, it is very painful. Infratrochlear, that is the infratrochlear branch here to the lower eyelid. Continue the branches of the nasociliary again. It will give the posterior thymoidal nerve, and this nerve will enter the posterior thymoidal canal to supply the sphenoidal air sinuses and sphenoidal air sinuses. The anterior thymoidal is a longer nerve. It will enter the anterior thymoidal canal through the anterior thymoidal foramen to reach the cranial cavity on the cranial cavity. It leaves the cranial cavity on a slit on the lateral side of the cribriform plate of the sphenoid to reach the nasal cavity. Here it's called the internal nasal within the nose, supplying the nose. It will give a branch to the skin of the nose, which we call it external nasal nerve. These are the branches of the nasociliary nerve. Now for the second large division, which is the maxillary division of the trigeminal nerve. The functions the same as the ophthalmic. It is pure sensory nerve, general somatic afferent. The course of that nerve is very interesting, as it will go through bony spaces all through. It passes in the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus below the ophthalmic, we have seen it, then leave the cranial cavity through the foramen retundum to reach the trigopalatine fossa on the back of the maxilla, leave that fossa through the trigomaxillary fissure to reach the infratemporal fossa, leaving immediately the infratemporal fossa. It's a very short or a curve in that fossa to reach the inferior orbital fissure, the inferior orbital fissure. From the inferior orbital fissure, it will be in the floor of the orbit, passing through the infraorbital groove, infraorbital canal, to leave from the infraorbital foramen. So from the foramen retundum, the trigopalatine fossa, through the trigomaxillary fissure to the infratemporal fossa, through the inferoorbital fissure to the infraorbital groove canal, and leave through the intraorbital foramen. The branches of this nerve, it has branches in the cranial cavity, which are the meningeal branch, and branches, this supply the outer layer of the dura, and branches in the tricho-palatine fossa, that region here from that line and backward, that part here, it will give a ganglionic to the sphenopalatine ganglia, and this very important branches, which will come as sensory branch to supply the nose, sensory branch to the tricho-palatine ganglia, as we said. Then a zygomatic branch, which is this one, will divide into zygomatico-temporal, this one, and zygomatico-facial, the other one here. As we said, the zygomatico-temporal carries secretory fibers to the lacrimal gland, which will be carried by the lacrimal nerve. The other branches, still in the tricho-palatine fossa, in the posterior superior alveolar, this one here, so you got the zygomatic, the posterior superior alveolar, and the ganglionic. And this will pierce the infratemporal surface of the maxilla. If you look at the back of the maxilla in a skull, you will find small foramina in the back. This is for the fibers of, or the branches of the posterior superior alveolar nerve, which will supply the maxillary sinus, the molar teeth, and give branches to the cheek and the gum. In the infraorbital canal now, it will give, which we call it infraorbital nerve now, will give the middle superior alveolar, this one, to the upper premolar teeth, the anterior superior alveolar, this one, which will give to the incisors and the canine teeth, and then end from the infraorbital foramen in the face will give palpebral, nasal, and labial to the lower eyelid, the nose, and the superior lip. That is the three branches. The last one is the mandibular nerve, which is a mixed nerve, having general somatic afferent and special visceral efferent fibers, motor fibers, to the muscles of the first pharyngeal arch. The course and relation is very short. It is the largest of the trigeminal nerve, formed of two roots, large sensory and small motor. Leave the skull through a foramen ovale to the infratemporal fossa, where the two roots unite to form the nerve trunk. The trunk lies medial to the lateral pterygoid and is a very short one, which divides immediately into anterior and posterior divisions. Branches of that nerve from the trunk, it will give the nervous spinosus, which pass up to the cranial cavity, supplying the outer layer of the dura in the middle cranial fossa. Nerve to medial pterygoid, which is a motor branch to the medial pterygoid, and it will give a branch to the otic ganglia. Through it, without relaying, it will supply the tensor palati and the tensor tympani. From the anterior division are muscular branches, the deep temporal to the temporalis, the lateral pterygoid, supply that muscle, masseteric to the masseter, and one sensory branch, the buccal nerve, which pass between the two heads of lateral pterygoid, supplying the skin over the cheek. From the posterior division, we have the auriculotemporal, which arise by two heads or two roots around the middle meningeal artery. That nerve passes deep to the neck of the mandible within the substance of the parotid to leave the gland through its upper end. We have seen it with the parotid gland. It carries both ganglionic secretory motor fibers from the otic ganglia to the parotid gland. It is sensory also to the external acoustic meatus articular branches to the temporomandibular joint and superficial temporal to the scalp, area of the scalp. That's how it looks like in a specimen, cadaveric specimen. That is the link, that is the nerve trunk to start with, giving the lingual nerve, the two larger branches which you can see here, the lingual and the inferior alveolar. So that is the lingual, which is joined by the corda tympani. If you can see it, a very thin nerve here coming from that angle to show in the lingual. It's very clear here. That is the one. It descends down is between the medial pterygoid and the ramus of the mandible. That is the medial pterygoid here. Then it lies behind the root of the third molar, where it's covered by the mucous membrane only of the mouse. That's a dangerous position during extraction of the last molar. In the submandibular region, it passes between the mylohyoid and the hyoglossus, deep to the submandibular gland to end in the tongue. That is the lingual again. It curves around the duct of the gland. That is the duct of the gland here. First lateral, inferior, and then medial to it. The tongue branches carry sensation from the mucous membrane of the mouth, the gum, the anterior side of the tongue, while the corda tympani, which joined the nerve in the infratemporal fossa, will, through that nerve, it supply the submandibular and the sublingual salivary gland parasympathetic fiber or secretory motor fibers, and it carries taste fibers from the anterior to third of the tongue. The second large one is the inferior alveolar, which we have seen it here. You can see the inferior alveolar here. As it enters the mandibular foramen into the mandibular canal, it can be seen within the mandibular canal here. And you can see also the nerve to mylohyoid as it arises from the inferior alveolar and goes down here. It descends deep to the lateral pterygoid in the infratemporal fossa. Then it passes between the ramus of the mandible and the sphenomandibular ligament to enter the mandibular canal. It runs in the canal as far as the foramen, mental foramen, where it will end by dividing into mental and incisive branches. Before it enters the canal, it will give the mylohyoid branch, which we have seen it here and here. That is the one here also. And this nerve will pierce the sphenomandibular ligament and descend in a groove on the medial side of the ramus of the mandible, end by supplying the mylohyoid and the anterior medial of the gastric. That is the inferior alveolar nerve. That is a summary of the branches of the mandibular nerve. Branches from the trunk is the nerve to medial pterygoid, this one, which supply the medial pterygoid, give a branch to the otic ganglion, which will end by supplying, it go without relay, of course, to the tensor tympani and the tensor palati muscles. The nervous spinosus comes from the trunk to end by supplying the dura mater, the middle cranial fossa, outer layer. From the anterior vision, you can see the nerve to lateral pterygoid, the nerve to temporalis, and the nerve to masseter, and the buccal nerve. From the posterior division, the auricular, the lingual nerve here, the inferior alveolar, and the auricular temporal. That is a very brief summary of the branches of the mandibular nerve, and this end the branches of the trigeminal nerve.